So I met Ian a couple years ago. The whole time that I've known him, he's been working on this book, and it's been really exciting for me. He comes back every time we meet up. He has great stories from just getting back from Hungary to going to a Columbia football game and meeting Ryan Fitzpatrick. And so I'm really excited to share some of those stories with you all. And I'd like everybody to welcome to the stage speedcuber and journalist Ian Scheffler. Welcome.
Thank you.
All right, so to get started, just what got you to start writing this book?
So has anyone here been to the Center for Talented Youth? Don't even know what I'm talking about, CTY? Okay, so it's a very unusual summer camp that Lady Gaga, Mark Zuckerberg, and Sergey Brin actually went to when they were kids. I attended the camp in the summer of 2005, 11 years ago. And on the very first day, I happened to sit next to the greatest Rubik's Cube solver on the planet. I had no idea that's what he was, but when he sat down to start class, he did something under the table, and I couldn't understand what it was, sort of clicky, and it turns out he was solving a Rubik's Cube without looking at it. So I sort of looked over, and the teacher was very upset. It sounded like an insect was buzzing around the room. It really bothered her, so she immediately banned cubes from the classroom, which of course made it extremely cool to have a Rubik's Cube. And by the end of the camp, almost all of us could solve one. That's pretty much where this would have ended. I got in trouble in high school for the same reason for teaching somebody. The teacher hated the noise. But then I found out that there were actually competitions. And the first competition I wanted to go to was at this dumpy casino in Las Vegas that has since been basically blown up for the last Jason Bourne film. But it was being run by the very kid who had taught me, who was at that point working in Silicon Valley. And I reached out to him and I said, can I come write about this? And he got kind of offended. He was like, you're not going to compete? And on the one hand, I thought maybe he wants my registration fee. But on the other hand, I was like, he has a legitimate point. How can you say you're writing about this with any sort of insider's perspective unless you really do it? And in the course of talking to him before that competition, I found out he and his brother essentially created the FIFA of Rubik's Cubes, the World Cube Association. And they're less corrupt because they have virtually no money, but they're in 77 countries. They have 60,000 members. Guinness defers to them for world records. And just to give you a taste of sort of how I started to get an inkling that there was a book in all of this, I was at this competition, and there were two things that really piqued my interest. So if any of you have been to like one of the low-rent Vegas casinos, you know there's just like garish carpet everywhere, and you sort of walk around and it muffles all the sounds. But I was standing outside this conference room, and whatever was going on inside was so energetic, so lively, that it sounded as if a hurricane had entered the building. And what it really was literally hundreds of these things being twisted at the same time. Like you could almost feel the floor vibrating. And the second thing that piqued my interest was later that evening, I was in a hallway in this casino, just taking notes on something I'd seen. And I hear a voice on my elbow, and there's a 12-year-old boy, like, I'm going to pretend Will's me, and I'm a 12-year-old boy. Hey, you want me to lube your cube? And I really wasn't sure how to reply, and then he just kept going. He's like, it'll really improve your performance. And I was just like, I didn't know what to say. He just kind of unbidden took out a syringe and just squirted some lube in there. And I lube my cube myself now, by the way. But I just started to learn that like there was more to this than I ever could have imagined. Rubik's Cube is at once very simple. As its creator told me, it's a finished object. It's complete. You don't even need instructions to understand how it works. And yet it is unfinished in the sense that it can inspire everything from computer science projects. Google, as some of you may know, is actually, and we'll talk about this, crucial in discovering what God's number was, which is the maximum number of solutions required to solve any case of the puzzle. It connects to art, connects to music, the rapper Logic. Some of you may have heard of him. He's really into Rubik's Cubes. He's got a track on his new album about it. There's athletes who do it. And so I just kind of fell down the rabbit hole, and that's where this all started.
Awesome. Well, how do you solve a Rubik's Cube then?
So raise your hand, obviously. Okay, well, I was going to say raise your hand if you've seen one, but I'm literally holding it, so you're all seeing it right now. But raise your hand if you've ever successfully solved a Rubik's Cube. Okay, I just want to say, never before when I've asked that question have most of the hands gone up, so kudos to everybody here. Pat yourselves on the back. There's lots of ways to solve it, right? So the number of permutations in just one Rubik's Cube is 43 quintillion. And change. And I know I don't have to explain what a quintillion to all of you is, but for anyone watching the video later, I'll just note, a quintillion is a billion times a billion. Like, I think I'm right on this. I did the math that if you wanted to, like, the average human body has about 37 trillion cells. I think that's the latest estimate. And so if you wanted to gather enough people to represent by the number of their cells, the number of possibilities in just one Rubik's Cube, you wouldn't need a conference room full of people or even an NFL stadium on a Sunday during a football game. You'd need all of San Francisco, which is 850,000 people plus 250,000 tourists. And again, I think I have the math right, but I know that someone will check me on that, so feel free to correct me.
Sounds right.
Okay, thank you. So we did an escape the room puzzle the other day, and he came in really handy. So the Rubik's Cube is obviously very complicated, but you know it can be reduced to some very simple problems. And I'm sure a lot of you, when you're dealing with engineering questions, have the same approach. You break things down into steps, you optimize those steps, you add it all together, you come to an optimal solution. So the way that I solved the Rubik's Cube, and I think this is probably the way most people in the room solve Rubik's Cube because it's the thing that got on the internet first. I mean, it's arguable whether or not it's the most optimal, but is you solve it in layers. So, you know, you can start on any side and you build one layer, and then you build another layer, and then the last layer. There are many, many different methods. A speedcuber in Britain named Alex Lau, who ironically his YouTube name is like five blind, like as if he were going to solve a 5x5 blindfolded, but he has never actually done this. He has done a video where he solves the Rubik's Cube under 20 seconds using actually 20 different methods, everything from the traditional layer by layer method to the Roux method, which is a block building method. There's methods that are, you know, conceptually it's almost like you're just building chunks of Legos and then slapping them together, as opposed to building, this is more like building a layer cake. I spent a lot of time thinking about metaphors that make this intelligible to people. So hopefully that makes sense. And he even tried like the human Kotziemba algorithm. A computer scientist named Herbert Kotziemba developed a program called the Cube Explorer, which is actually still in use with some scrambling programs as a way to generate, you know, random positions of the puzzle. And you know, you can try to emulate the way the computer program works. So essentially, when you're solving layer by layer, you are just trying to, you know, build up from the bottom.
Awesome. What kind of math figures into Rubik's Cubes?
So again, this is probably the only room I will ever be in where people will actually raise their hands. How many of you have heard of group theory? This makes me so happy. So there's actually a class at Cal Berkeley on the Rubik's Cube in the math department, and they do talk about some of this there. I group theory obviously figures into a lot of people's everyday lives in ways they don't know. But it's the branch of mathematics that's most closely related to this, and the way I often explain it to people, and again, I know I'm preaching to the choir, but for anyone watching later, I'll just give a metaphor or two. You know, commutators and conjugates are very basic operations in group theory that apply to Rubik's Cube every time you solve it. Just a side note, one of the people who started the World Cube Association challenged a friend of his in college to solve it. That friend became like a tenured professor in geophysics at Caltech when he was in his 20s. So like he's got some brain power up there. And he came up with a commutator, and it was like an insanely inefficient solution, but you know, he'd solved it overnight. So you know, the way I like to think about these things is how they relate to everyday life. Like, you know, everyone is a conjugate, for instance, is just an operation, then another operation, and the inverse of the first operation, which is what we're all doing when we get something out of the fridge, right? Like, you know, you open the door, which is the first operation, then you take the sandwich out, which is the second operation, then you close the door. And the benefit of these sorts of things is, you know, if you took a pickaxe to the fridge to get your sandwich, you wouldn't have a fridge afterward. And in the same way, if you say solve the first two layers of the cube or like a chunk of it, you know, maybe you have to mess it up to put something else in place, but you want to preserve what you've already built.
That's awesome. Okay, well, you met Ernő Rubik while writing this book. And what was it like to meet this reclusive Hungarian architect?
So I like to think of Mr. Rubik as like the Willy Wonka of Eastern Europe, because he's very wealthy, he's very private, and he's really brilliant. It actually took me 2 years to get a 1-hour interview with him. And literally until like the day before the interview, I didn't know it was going to happen. I was in Budapest and I was just waiting. I was like, I really hope this is going to happen. Like, I really hope I didn't just come here. And then one of his people, because of course he has lots of people, is like, Mr. Rubik will meet you at 12:30 p.m. tomorrow at this restaurant. And I was like, I will be there. And he's actually so under the radar in Hungary. And so just to back up for a second, when he invented this, he was 29 years old. He was living at home with his mother behind the Iron Curtain in communist Hungary, which is perhaps the least auspicious place in history to develop a successful commercial product. And he didn't even know that he was inventing a puzzle. I mean, initially he created just a 2x2 Rubik's Cube. I don't know if you know what those are. It's just, you know, a 2x2 square one. And it was about the same size, so the blocks were very big, and it was just wooden pieces. You can see this on display now in the Beyond Rubik's Cube exhibit, which is traveling the globe. It's in, I think, Shanghai now. And he used, in fact, paper clips and rubber bands and some he drilled into the corners to put this together. And there's actually a variety of competing narratives about why he invented the puzzle and exactly how he did. And he himself hasn't always been entirely clear. Like, it's impossible, I think, for all of the stories I've heard to be true. You know, because he's been so under the radar, rumors, you know, build up. Like someone told me, oh, you know, I heard he lives in a castle with one floor for every one of his children, which is not true. You know, or he could have, you know, he owns one of the hills of Budapest, which is not true. Although I was told by one of his inner circle folks that back in the 80s, he literally could have bought half the entire country of Hungary because he had so much more foreign cash than anybody else. You know, just factories and giant fields and everything else. But he's a very modest man, and that was not why he invented this. He invented this because, you know, he's a thinker. He's a dreamer. He's someone who interacts with shapes and forms the way the rest of us interact with, you know, just our everyday lives, words, talking to people around us. And what seems to be the case, there is actually an out-of-print academic book in which he, I think it's the only time he wrote a first-person account of why he invented the cube. And ironically, he even says in it, you know, I'm aware that if I don't say anything, people will invent stuff. And yet it was an essay published in an obscure academic book that no one has ever read. So I don't know how many favors it's done him. But if you go find it, it's called the Rubik's Cubic Compendium. I got an out-of-print copy in London. And I'm sure you can get it on the internet. And he talks about, you know, the cube for him is almost a part of him. He's referred to it as his child. Like, he has this very close personal relationship to it. He talks about it not as Rubik's cube, because he is Rubik. It's a possessive. He says, my cube. which is sort of a funny thing that a lot of people don't realize. It's like, you know, I've seen it misspelled R-U-B-I-X all the time, or, you know, that's why I never say the Rubik's cube. And I've had a lot of cubers ask me, why don't you say the Rubik's cube? Because in the book, I really rarely refer to it that way. And I said, well, you know, do you say the Einstein's theory of relativity? Like, no, it's Einstein's. Like, it was his. And obviously, there's lots of discoveries in history, you know, in particular in the sciences, where multiple people discovered something at the same time, or there's, you know, competing narratives about who this really belongs to. And that's certainly true of this in the sense that there were people around the world who, you know, simultaneously came up with similar products, but, you know, his was the one that made it big. But, you know, I want to, when I say Rubik's Cube, I want to try to communicate there is a history to this puzzle. There's a specific story behind it, which hadn't really been pulled together before, and that's part of what this book's about. So back to the original question about meeting Rubik, it was one of the strangest experiences of my, you know, young writing career, because I had these two competing incentives, one of which was to collect as much information as I could in that 1 hour to bring back to people who will read the book, to bring back to people I will talk to, because, you know, there's very little information out there about him that is as direct as someone talking to him. But then the other impulse was I just wanted to have lunch with Ernő Rubik, because, like, who gets to do that, right? So I was, you know, furiously scribbling in my notebook and also just being like, oh, yes, that was a nice thing. Yes, keep going. You know, I wanted to really be there. And just to set the scene, we were in a restaurant in Budapest. And also in Hungary, most people think he's dead. Because he's so, like, if you go to the castle district in Hungary, which is the sort of oldest historic center of Budapest, you can go into a museum underground, and it's advertised outside with these posters of, you know, warriors on horseback. It's like, learn about the country's history. And I'm sure it's geared toward, like, you know, kids who want to go to Legoland, that sort of thing. But the video literally starts with an image of the entire globe, like, turning towards UC Hungary, and then it morphs into an enormous Rubik's Cube. And, you know, Hungary has produced some of the world's greatest inventors. The ballpoint pen was invented by a Hungarian, Laszlo Biro. That's where, you know, Biro, the pen brand, comes from. The greatest female chess player in history, Judit Polgár, is Hungarian. George Soros, the investor, is Hungarian. There's a lot of Hungarians that one could pick to begin a movie about the entire country's history with, but literally the only person who gets singled out visually is Ernő Rubik. They actually used to have Rubik's Cube on the stamps. Like, it's a very big part of national pride. You can walk down major shopping streets in Hungary, and there will be little tchotchkes, which are probably not licensed, to be honest, but little tchotchkes in the same way that we have Empire State Building keychains and underwear. There is Rubik's Cube underwear, by the way. And there's just all this sort of stuff that it's just part of, you know, the oxygen over there. So this lady running the projector, I asked her, you know, can you rewind it so I can take notes? I was not anticipating Rubik's Cube being part of this story in that movie. It was being shown in a medieval chapel, like deep underground. So it's, you know, you wouldn't expect to see the cube there. Also, just one more side note, even the subway stations are Rubik's Cube themed in some parts of Budapest. Like, there are, you know, are murals and things, and I've asked people who work for Rubik, is this like intentional? And they're like, yes, but it's just off enough that they don't have to license it. Like it's, you know, just a little different. Like there's some purple and there's no purple on the cube. So I asked her, can you rewind? And she dutifully did so, and I took some notes on this. And then I asked her, you know, what do you know about the Rubik's Cube? And she said, well, you know, I know most foreigners don't know that it's Hungarian, and we are very proud of the fact that it is Hungarian. It's sort of their biggest cultural export, even though no one even knows they're exporting it. And then I said, do you know anything about Ernő Rubik? And she sort of looked at me with this sort of cocked head, like, you know, are you asking about dinosaurs? Like, what? I haven't seen any of those recently. And she just said, isn't he dead? And I sort of, I paused and I said, I hope not, because I don't want them to wheel a corpse out of London tomorrow. So, you know, he keeps a low profile, and such a degree that, like, when I got off, although he's very distinct. I mean, if you've ever seen a photo of him, and I describe this in the book, you can find it online. He has a very angular face, like extremely blue eyes, the sort of wispy gray hair. He looks very much, as you might imagine, an inventor would. And obviously, he's invented other puzzles besides Rubik's Cubes. I just got off this streetcar, and he was just sitting outside in this restaurant, kind of like looking at me. Just like, and I was just like, you know, there he is. Like, this is actually happening. So we wound up having a conversation, which I recount in the book. You know, for someone who is not directly injecting himself into the mainstream of cubing in terms of going and talking about it, although he has been more recently, he keeps up to date with, you know, not only what's happening with the latest records. I mean, when I was in Hungary, the world record for a speed solve of the 3x3 was broken and set lower to 5.25 seconds. And he knew about that. He was keeping on top of everything. And he's just an enormously, you know, gifted and multivalent man, if I could use that term in this context. He cites among his influences everybody from Da Vinci to Isaac Asimov. His father was one of Hungary's most renowned engineers who designed gliders and planes, some of which Rubik has told me you can still see flying above the skies in Budapest, like training planes. And his father won the Kossuth Prize, which is named after a major figure in Hungary's history. And it's like the highest prize for engineering given by the state. And then his mother was a poet. So he's literally the union of art and science. And in other words, it really makes a lot of sense that he would have invented this puzzle.
Awesome. Oh. What was the hardest part of writing a book about Rubik's cubing?
So the funny thing is, like, the narrative of this book follows my own journey, right? So like when I went to that summer camp, I was actually challenged by the kid who taught me, whose name is Toby Mao, to go under 20 seconds, which at the time was really, really hard. And it's still not easy. The term for that is sub 20. So in our summer camp yearbook, he didn't even say nice to meet you or enjoy the rest of the summer. He just said, hit sub 20. He didn't even say, like, you know, nice to meet you, Toby, or something. It was just hit sub 20. It was this goal he set me. And at the time, I was like, there's no way I'm ever going to do this. I averaged around 2 minutes at the time. And when I saw him solve a Rubik's Cube, I didn't really understand what was going on. There was one other kid who was as fast as he was from the Philippines. And they would duel on the playground. They would sort of square their legs almost as if they were sumo wrestlers just about to charge at each other. But instead, all their energy went into this like little space in between their hands. And they would trade cubes and scramble them. And since I had a wristwatch, I was the designated referee. I just got you know, press ganged into this. And as a result, I got to watch them do it over and over and over. And cubing attracts some very competitive personalities, and Toby is certainly no exception. He became the world's greatest Rubik's Cube solver, said, okay, enough with that. Became an almost professional World of Warcraft player, said, enough with that. I mean, you know, he's the kind of person who, like, he and his wife met at a cubing competition. Funnily enough, his older brother had, like, taken her out for prom. It's a bit of a weird story. But they don't like dancing, but they do like jujitsu and solving Rubik's Cubes. So instead of a first dance, they invented the noble sport of cube jitsu, where in front of the whole wedding party, they put on their gis and they pulled out a mat. And then whoever gets the other person to submit first or solves the cube wins. And she was choking him out. He was about to go under, and then he solved it with one hand and won. So this is the guy who taught me. So imagine him when he was 14 years old. And he just wouldn't stop with the competitions. Like, you know, one day I wore a t-shirt that said, you know, it was this visual gag my grandfather sent me. So he's sending me these little gag things, you know, like something you'd throw in someone's tailpipe to make it sound like it was exploding. Really responsible adult, right? So this t-shirt said, you know, read the colors in which the words are written. And there were maybe like 36 colors, like blue, red, green, orange, but they were all printed in different colors, except for white, which was like the trick color. It actually was white. And when Toby saw that, he was like, how fast has anyone done that yet? I'm like, literally no one has thought of this. This is not even a competition. It's not a sport. And he said, I want you to time me, though. And I was like, OK. He kind of just cornered me. And I was like, all right, ready, set, go. And he did it. And then he's like, no, Andrew has to find out if I'm faster or slower than him. So he brought over this other kid. And then I just sort of sat there while lunch sort of, you know, ticked away. And I was like, I can't wear this shirt ever again. That's really what the story is here. So I had no idea how he did any of those things. Like, I knew he was competitive. I knew there was some element of him that was unique that allowed him to get to the level he was. But he was very insistent, as a lot of people in this world are, and I'm now count myself as one of these converted, that anyone can do this. Like, anyone can solve a Rubik's Cube, you know, fast. It just takes a certain amount of perseverance and knowledge, which you can acquire from other people or develop on your own. But it is, in fact, extremely difficult. Like, solving a Rubik's Cube, you know, you can learn in a few hours to do it. But solving it fast is about, as I learned, and this is sort of what the subtitle alludes to, going slow to go fast. There's something that's quasi-meditative and almost spiritual about going fast while solving Rubik's Cubes. And I know this sounds like totally hocus-pocus mumbo-jumbo, probably, to you, which is how it sounded to me. Like, I once had a conversation with Felix Zemdeg. Some of you may have heard of him. He's been called the Usain Bolt of solving Rubik's Cube. He's an Australian teenager. And I mean, the reason they call him Usain Bolt is he was the first to break the 10-second barrier. And you know, he could solve it faster than Usain Bolt. So I think he was 13 with braces at the time. And someone made like a, you know, image online of like Felix with his braces. And then there was Usain Bolt, and they had just crossed Bolt out. Like, he's no longer the world's fastest man. So, you know, Felix said to me when I was asking, like, what's going through your head? Like, what's happening when you are solving it in like 5 seconds? Because at that point, he had the record at like 5.6 seconds. He had this sort of cryptic Yoda-like pronouncement, and I sort of wondered, am I really talking to a kid in flip-flops right now? He's like, you know, the faster you go, the slower it feels. And I was just like, but that doesn't make any sense. Like, the faster you go, the faster you're going, right? Like, why? That's not at all apparent. But I had a sort of conversion moment of my own when cubing, as far as cubing goes, and you'll actually read about this in the first chapter, where, like, at the World Championship in 2013, I was not doing super well. Like, if you're solving a Rubik's Cube in front of hundreds of people, you have a liability to get nervous and your hands get sweaty. One of my cubing buddies, Andy Smith, a former national champion, actually has like a personalized handkerchief that's like got an embroidered Rubik's Cube, and he like wipes his hands before every solve. You know, and, you know, he could probably use a little powder or something, but you know, because it gets slippery and you're moving it very fast. But a veteran cuber said to me, you know, just try going slower. Just like, don't push yourself. Go 80%. Adrenaline will kick in and you'll go faster. Don't even look at the timer. And I thought, well, you know, what do I have to lose? It's my fifth solve. In competition, you do an average of 5 solves. And you know, at that time, I had finally broken a minute, which was exciting. But I knew that I wasn't anywhere near my goal of going under 20 seconds. So I decided not look at the timer. And excuse me, I just started my solve. And I thought to myself, this is the slowest solve I've ever done. Like, I was just watching every move. I was like, OK, you're doing that part, and you're doing that part, and then that part. And I was picturing, like, this is easily going to break a minute. Like, this is going to be like a minute and 10 seconds or something. And I just was not, like, I put it down very softly, almost as if I was just like ending a little piece on the piano. And I looked down at the timer, and it was like 33 seconds. And I was like, I've never gone that fast. Like, what happened? And like, they were all like, yeah, that's what happens, though. Like, that's how this works. And I don't know if you've heard like the psychological term flow. I talk a bit about it in the book. There's a Hungarian dude, and excuse me if there are any Hungarians and I'm butchering the pronunciation. I think it's Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. He wrote about this back in the 90s in a very popular book. And you know, he's described how anyone can sort of enter this flow state, whether or not you're a factory worker or a ballerina. But it's one of those moments, and if you've ever done sports or music or dance, you know, you're liable to have experienced this, where you know, you're just so in the moment that every second becomes almost, you know, dilated, and it's just like you're really in the zone. You know, this is sort of, I guess you might compare it to a runner's high. Also, by the way, this is why we're all so obsessed with the Rubik's Cube, because it's just like, I've had 13-year-old kids be like, it's like getting high. Like, it feels so good to go that fast. It's just this heady sensation of just time itself opening up, and you never feel more present than in that moment. But as you get faster, you get acclimated to it. So then you have to get faster to get that feeling again. So, like, I thought I would stop. You know, you get hooked. Like, I thought I would stop after I got under 20 seconds. Like, okay, let's put it on the resume. You've solved a Rubik's Cube in 20 seconds. But, like, I find myself late at night, and I'm just like, okay, just 5 more solves. Just 5 more solves. And I'm down to, like, 13 at home now, which is really exciting. And I, you know, all my cubing buddies are like, yeah, like, you don't stop. Like, once you make that decision to start seeing how fast you can go, it's just, you know, it's done. You're just going to do this forever. And speaking of doing it forever, as you'll meet in the book, there are characters who, like, you know, it's part of their life in a very funny degree. My friend Ron van Broekum, he's a Dutchman who works for Rabobank, and he runs the World Cube Association. He's one of the board members. I mean, you know, literally there's no room in his house, including the bathroom, that does not have Rubik's Cubes. You cannot go anywhere without being able to solve one. So it was very hard, to go back to the original question, to learn to do it fast. I got injured at a point. It turned into the Karate Kid, where like these little kids were teaching me things, you know, like sort of the cubing equivalents of wax on and wax off. I was also trying to do this at the same time that I was trying to write a book, but I couldn't finish the book until I like achieved the end of the narrative, because you can't write a book where it's like his goal is under 20 seconds and goodbye. Like, it can't just be he kept trying, you know, he has to get somewhere, there has to be some resolution. And when I finally, like, you know, got under 20 seconds, I had a sense of what the sort of arc of the narrative was. I mean, you want your hero to suffer in a story, right? There needs to be the hero's journey, but when you're the main character, you don't want to be doing that much suffering. But the struggle of solving the cube provided a lot of suffering, but I think it makes for a better story. So, you know, all of that together is what made it very challenging.
That's awesome. So speaking of solving, do you want to, like, get some people up here and solve a cube?
Yeah, that sounds wonderful. So we have some volunteers. And if they want to come up.
I sent an email out, so like if you got an email from me, if we've been in communication, you should come up on stage.
And if you need extra cubes, I have lots.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah, so some like Googlers, yeah, give them a round of applause.
Okay, you need a cube. Okay, just you take one of these, anyone you want.
Yeah, take one of Ian's because they're better.
Okay. Yeah, and I have actually, I think I might have a couple more I can bring out.
Awesome. Ready?
Yeah.
Set, go. And I have a timer here, but we can maybe broadcast that to the video. Nice.
Thanks, Will.
Yeah. I could cheer you on. Nice. There's another one. That was fast. You could just come steal one if you want.
Very nice. Oh.
Ian, you're getting help.
Very nice. I mean, at the end of the day, it's always us against the cube, right? So. Will, this is your cube, right?
Yeah, it's awful.
It's blue plastic. It's very confusing.
It's going to really slow you down, I think.
Oh, so we're all, well, okay, well, the teams aren't done, so let's just see if I can finish this one in time.
Yeah, your cubes have all been solved.
Well, I think someone twisted your cube. Like, it's technically in a different universe
really?
Right now. Yeah.
That's awesome.
That's actually the group theory term. I'm not cheating. I'm, like, putting it back in the universe where this is solvable. although, I don't know if I can. It's really, did your dog do this? This is really good here. I think I'm going to give up on that one. It's just going to stay in the unsolvable universe.
How do you know it's unsolvable?
It's not a legal position here.
I see.
It can't resolve. So did everyone solve their cubes? We're almost done?
Close.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
Well, I don't know. I can start on the 4x4. We might be here for a little while.
I don't want to, like, torture people and just stand here and stare as you.
Okay. I know. Do we want to just applaud and say
yeah,
what?
Let's.
Okay, good job, everybody. So I know these are kind of mixed up, but, you know, feel free to take your cubes back, or we can sort it out later.
Yeah.
And congrats, because this is literally the only reading I'll ever do where this many people on stage can solve it. So, good job, everybody.
I mean, Ian can talk for, like, a long time. So if you have any questions for him, we have two mics. Feel free to use the mics and ask him some questions. If you don't have questions, it looks like you do. Then I can just feed him some more. But let's do this.
So when I grew up, I had this Rubik's Cube and I tried to solve it, trying to figure out how to solve it without looking up the answer.
Yes.
And for 10 years, I struggled. I was never able to figure out how to solve it. So I did what everyone else did, just went on YouTube and found out and learned how to do it. I was wondering if you can tell us how, like, people first found out how to solve it.
That's a really good question, because your experience is not at all uncommon. I've interviewed hundreds of people over the course of this project, and I think I can count on one hand the number of people who figured it out on their own. Now, there's a good story about Rubik in here, because when he invented it, he didn't actually know it could be solved. And he had to figure it out if there was a solution, right? There's an apocryphal story that, which again, it's apocryphal, it may or may not be true, but he came out of his room and said to his mom, like, I just can't. I can't do it. And she's like, of course you can. Like, clearly it started solved. You must be able to solve it. And then he was like, kind of admitted defeat and walked back and sort of kept working. It's like, actually, when this was licensed later on, the American toy company that was going to make a deal with it, they sort of said, like, you know, you have to show us that it can be solved. And the Hungarians were like, they said what Rubik's mom did, like, but you realize by logic, it must be solvable if it starts solved. And the Americans are like, no, none of this logic. Like, we need a demonstration. And they did it, and then it sort of worked out. But there have been, I guess, kind of a number of independent discoveries. Like, within the Cuban community, there's a small degree of contention about this in the sense that, like, the method that, you know, I use layer by layer, it's some people call it the Friedrich method, after Jessica Friedrich, this woman who helped popularize it and helped invent part of it. But, you know, some of the Dutch folks, they prefer CFOP, an acronym, because, you know, there were Dutch people who independently discovered these things first. But as far as figuring out, a lot of it was trial and error. There weren't computer programs that were in sort of common circulation now where you can sort of explore the cube mathematically. A much more popular method at first, because it's more intuitive and there are a few algorithms, is corners first. I don't know if you're familiar with that one. It's like you orient and permute all of the corners and then you do the edges. And when you see someone do it that way, it's really interesting because it's like such a different style. It's almost like you're watching someone, you know, tango instead of salsa, if you know what cubing is about. But yeah, at the first World Championship in 1982, there was an enormous diversity of methods. Like the top three finishers, I think, they had two different corners first methods, and then someone did a layer by layer. The top finisher was actually a man named Minh Thai, who was a Vietnamese refugee to the U.S. And he, I think, had learned part of it from a book, but part of it on his own. The person I think I'm personally most impressed with is my late friend Peter Butterfield, who back in the 80s, he was an engineer. He worked at Hughes Aircraft later on. He was just at home in this horribly hot week with his, you know, young daughter, and he had nothing to do, and she was ill. And so he invented literally his own method, which was sort of a rudimentary layer by layer one. He was a real brainiac. And I think he wrote it down, so it's somewhere. But does that answer your question?
Did Mr. Rubik himself actually found an answer, or did he just...
Yes, he did find an answer, and he actually, I mean, he had to, because there was no one else out there who could do this. Literally for years, he was the only person on the planet who could solve it. Even when it got to the point of marketing it, and this is part of the reason it took so long to market, was like, if you're at a toy fair, and you're like a wholesaler, and someone's like, I have this amazing puzzle, and they're like, great, show it to us. And it's like, I can't. Like, that's not a good sales pitch, but that's really something that happened. And so he, when this first came to the US and they were showing it to wholesalers, this is literally how it was described to me, and that's how I describe it in the book. He was almost like an organ grinder's monkey, where it's just like they would just pull him into these, you know, rope him in these little rooms, and he was just kind of stuck there. It's like, yes, I'll solve it for you too, and you, and you. So yes, he figured out a method, and he's been asked, like, how fast were you? What are the details? It seems clear that it was a corners first method. And he never tried to optimize it for speed. I mean, you know, just enough so that he could solve it in a short amount of time, like maybe a minute. That's about how fast he got. But yeah, he did, in fact, have to entirely discover his own method.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I had the same two questions, so I'll go on a different tangent then. If I recall, one of his other puzzles was the one with the rings and the squares that you flip over.
The magic,
and so on.
Yes.
And he had two versions of that. The eight.
Master magic, yeah. Yes.
And probably he did a whole bunch of other stuff. So I'm wondering which of those other puzzles that you think is also great. And the other question is, there's many other cubes. There's like 4 or 5 and so on. And there's the X cube, for example. Are all methods to solve the basic 3x3 equally applicable to all of these other variants?
Okay. Do you mind if I answer your last question
first?
Okay. So as far as solving methods, I'm not an expert on like every single puzzle, but with every cubic puzzle, you can in fact reduce it to a 3x3 puzzle. If you say solve all the center pieces, then it, you know, and then, you know, solve all the edge bars, then it becomes, you know, like solving. Yeah. I actually saw on Instagram a while back an engineer who I follow like showed his 5x5 Rubik's cube on his shelf, or maybe it was his 6x6 or 7x7, and he was solving it one layer at a time, and I was like, oh my God, how long is this taking you? Like, that's a real challenge. But you can reduce it. Most any cubic puzzle you can turn into a 3x3, you know, and the same goes for 2x2, even though there's no centers, it's just the corners that you're solving. You run into parity issues with some cubes. You know, obviously if there's an odd number of squares on each edge, there's a fixed centerpiece, but if it's an even number, there's not a fixed centerpiece. There's algorithms that you can do to deal with parity problems. I'm sure I don't have to explain parity to any of you guys, but you know, like if parity issues can be solved just by rotating the internal slices to change parity from even to odd. But there is, in the course of writing this book, I got to meet a really cool group of people whom I hope to follow up with to some extent, because they didn't quite make it in, people who design puzzles that have never before existed. And you know, if the Rubik's Cube people are characters, these people are like characters squared, because you know, there's one man in San Francisco, George Miller, a retired technology executive, who you know, he's so into this, he threw out his washer and dryer and replaced them with a 3D printer. And I don't know how he does the laundry anymore, but I'm not really sure he cares. You know, he's got puzzles that are so elaborate, there's only like 20 of them in the world. Like, basically, it was me meeting him, was him leading me around his apartment being like, what do you think of that table, Ian? And I'm like, I don't know, George, what about it? And he's like, just see. And everything was a puzzle. Every single thing in the house is a puzzle. The statues are puzzles, the tables are puzzles. He has a table called the Lotus Table, which is one of only 20 in the world. It costs as much as a new car. You'd think it's just beautiful inlaid wood. But the tabletop is made of 10 concentric rings that you can spin to create 4 million different patterns. Yeah. And there are 6 drawers shaped like lotus petals, and each one will only open if you get the right pattern on the top. And you know, so either it's the best way to hide your valuables or the easiest ways to lose a lot of money because someone just will destroy it. But the clues to the patterns are hidden in the table themselves, like they're carved in secret places and stuff. I mean, I was like, he got a little frustrated with me, but I think his wife doesn't like puzzles, so like he was happy to have a captive victim. You know, there was also the sculpture in the hallway, this tennis player who's, you know, I was at first, he was like, what do you think? I was like, well, it's a nice sculpture. But then he's like, take her belt off. And I was like, what? Excuse me? And it turns out the belt of the statue is a rope that's knotted, but it has no beginning or end. He showed me a homologue to this sculpture, which is just a little wire puzzle where you have to take the chain off. But that's just a side note, that if you want to learn more about puzzles like this, I don't think I'm the expert, but there are people who, I believe it's called the International Puzzle Party. I don't think they've been in any elections, but this is their name. And once a year, they have their International Puzzle Party, and everyone brings a table that is heretofore unknown. And they do a little, their puzzle Olympics. There's a man named Nob Yoshigahara, who was Japanese, and he's reputed as one of the greatest puzzle designers of that world. I mean, his puzzles are works of art. Like, I held one once that was a hand-carved piece of wood that it was like a saucer and a teacup, and there were 2 little sugar cubes on top and a spoon. But it was all stuck together, and you couldn't separate the cup and the saucer. And the cubes, you move them around, you realize there's magnets inside the little sugar cubes on top, and there's a mechanism hidden inside this piece of wood, which was carved in entirety, that like you have to move the magnets around to change something in there to separate this. So if you want to learn more about X cubes, that sort of thing, I would suggest checking them out. And your first question, remind me what that was?
About the other puzzles that Rubik's did, and is there like any secret puzzle or something that he showed you that you...
Oh, well, I actually showed him a puzzle he hadn't seen because I wanted to see his reaction. I brought a puzzle from that George Miller who, you know, to see how Rubik would react, and he immediately just sort of like retreated and was just like, this is more interesting than you, go away. you know, he was engrossed in solving that. But I'm certainly not privy to like whatever he's cooking up these days. I know that he's still very active in designing things. He's also a practicing architect. He has an architecture firm and has designed all kinds of things. But he has made, to my knowledge, the Rubik's Snake, which was not so much a puzzle you solve, a sort of you transform it from a ball to a snake and back. There's the Rubik's Magic, which, as was described, is, you know, these sheets of plastic with rings printed on them, and you have to move it from one position to another. That actually was a competition puzzle until an optimal solution was reached that was the same every time. So it became less a test of, you know, your logical skill than just, you know, can you have a seizure below the wrists effectively enough? You know, like, can you just turn it really fast? And so that was eliminated as a competition item. You know, the world record was down to like 0.9 seconds or something. It was really absurd. I mean, I'm serious. Like, I would see people do it, and it looked like they had just suddenly spasmed, and then it was solved. And I was like, I don't even know what you did. It was very frustrating for me. You know, some of the other puzzles, so he invented the 3x3, but some of the other puzzles were actually invented by other folks, like the Pyraminx, which is a pyramidal twisty puzzle, was invented by a man, I'm forgetting his name right now, Uwe Meffert, who lives in Hong Kong. He's also from Europe. The 4x4 was invented, I think, by, it was either the 4x4 or 5x5 was invented by a Czech man, and then it was later licensed, and the same goes, I think, with the Magic might actually have been invented by someone else and licensed by Rubik. He hasn't invented all of the puzzles that fall under this. There was a, especially because the engineering challenge of building a larger twisty puzzle, it gets really complicated, like a 7x7. If you take one apart, and I don't necessarily recommend doing this because it will take hours to clean and put back together, those were originally created by a Greek engineer, and I may be butchering the name, Panagiotis Verdis. You know, there's all kinds of different mechanisms inside to hold it together. So I think my favorite is really the 3x3. That was one of your questions as well, right? My favorite is the 3x3, and I think that really, you know, everything else kind of comes back to that. Like, if you can solve a 3x3, you can solve most of the other puzzles. It's also so much, it's so much more complicated. It's so much less facile a problem than, say, the Pyraminx. Like, I was given a Pyraminx, and I said, okay, I want to actually know what it's like to figure out one of these things on my own, and I did it in, like, half an hour. Like, it's not super, super complicated. The order of permutations, it's, like, you know, 10 to the 6 or something like that. Like, it's much smaller. I think what impressed me about him most was that his intellect and interest wasn't just puzzles. It sort of extended to art and all these other sorts of things. He's been focused on, like, this exhibit that he designed recently that, you know, showed the different ways the cube's been done. Like, there's, you know, it shows the riffs on this. Like, there's a jewelry company once made a cube that I think is valued at several million dollars. It's got, like, you know, each side is a different precious stone. It's all platinum and white gold. Also, Pharrell Williams has a solid gold Rubik's cube, I think, studded with diamonds, but that wasn't part of the exhibit. Did I answer your questions?
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. So I had two questions.
Yes.
One is, so in speed solving, the measure of optimality is the time you solve it. I mean, the other measure could be the number of moves you take. And so I was wondering whether, you know, that idea has found interest or there are competitions around that, because that seems more resistant to, like, you can't memorize a set of algorithms and just try to do that all the time, you know.
Yes. So this is how I know that I'm getting old in cubing years, is that this is the problem I'm more interested in, because my hands just can't keep up with the kids. But there is actually a competition called the fewest moves competition. And if you go to a large competition, it's almost like the Olympics. There's I think, 17 different official WCA events, which range from solving with your feet. The world record for that is down to like 20 seconds now, believe it or not. There's one guy in Poland who's like a chimpanzee. He can just like pick it up and do it. I got to see him live, and it was really surreal. And then it was him dueling against this guy from Brazil, and the Japanese guy was just like sitting on the floor doing it. It's interesting sort of the way cultural differences play out in this. So the fewest moves competition has been around for, I guess, since 2003. And the world record started out at, I think, 28 moves. And it has since fallen down to 19. So actually, this is a great opportunity to talk about God's number. So raise your hand if you've heard of the God's number problem. And are you aware that, like, keep your hand raised if you're aware that Google actually played a major role in this? Did any of you actually, were you involved in the research, any of you? No, okay. So for a long time it bedeviled, you know, cubologists, if I could use that term. Cubists used to be the term of preference, but obviously there's a bit of overlap with the art movement. No one wants to confuse us with, like, you know, Picasso, et cetera. The problem is sort of knotty, right? It seems very simple. Like, you know, what is the optimal solution? Like, how, given a sample space, you know, a space of possible positions this large, you know, what's the minimum number? Like, the way I always like to think about it is, you know, if there's just a giant cloud of all the positions and, like, the solved one is in the center, like, what's the quickest path from any position to the center? A problem was sort of approached from two sides. Like, you know, there was, like, a minimum and, like, a maximum. They kind of got closer over the years, and it got down to, and this was all with a lot of computers and that sort of thing, it got down to, like, it could be, like, between 20 and 22 inclusive, like, we don't really know. And then Google was generous enough to lend some supercomputers for the problem, which eventually cracked it. And we now know that, like, the maximum number of moves required to solve any position is just 20, which is, we call God's number, because if there were an omniscient being solving this, you know, it would only take 20 moves every time. Funnily enough, though, that world record of 19 moves, it was still suboptimal because the optimal was 18. So finally, a human was under 20, and it's like, you're still not God, though. Like, you're not. I just want to throw out there, so I don't know if any of you know the writer Simon Rich. He's a comedian. In one of his novels called What in God's Name, which imagines sort of what's going on in heaven if heaven were like a corporation with a bit of an absentee CEO who's more interested in watching NASCAR drivers thank him than paying attention to, say, climate change. He has a Rubik's Cube on his desk, the deity character in the novel, and he's really proud of himself for getting two sides done. But in this problem's imagination, like, you could optimally solve it. And you're right, it is in fact a very different kind of, it requires a totally different set of thinking and skills, because if you're solving fast, you know, sometimes you willfully go for something that's not optimal because it is faster to execute. Like, I've gotten to the point with my own cubing where I can pay attention to and critique what I'm doing while I'm doing it. Like, at a competition recently, I recognized a second after I did something that was not an optimal move, but I knew that if I went back to do the fewer number of moves, it would take more time, so I just committed to the bad decision I'd already made and, you know, wound up rescuing the solve, and it was still under 20 seconds, and that was fine. But I recently, like I say, got into this sort of fewest moves, and like the degree of knowledge required for that is really astounding. There's a young man named Tim Reynolds who actually works at Google in the Cambridge office. I don't know if any of you know of him. He's a very active member of the community. He organizes a lot of competitions, and he's very, very good at the fewest moves competition. And it requires a toolkit that's totally different. It's not just algorithms, it's sort of cube knowledge, right? It's understanding how this puzzle works mathematically, you know, physically inside and out. And one thing I really enjoy doing, and anyone who wants to learn more about this, I encourage you to go on the cubing forums, like speedsolving.com, and there's an international language of Rubik's Cube that spells out all of the moves. It's like chess notation. And following along with their solutions is really awe-inspiring for me, and it's almost like reading poetry or like listening to Mozart, because you can spend hours like dissecting, like, how did they do this? Like, what led to the final thing? Because it's never always apparent when you start with the solution. It's like you look as if it's just constantly chaotic, and then finally it winds up solved before you know it. One thing that may interest you, a lot of people, some that has been developed, is you can actually invert the scramble, because everyone gets a scramble. It's sort of like a fun version of the SAT. It's like you are given a scramble, you're all put in a room with some pencils, and like you have to solve this as optimally as you can. And then, you know, you can invert the scramble and try to sort of go from both directions to figure out if there's some move you haven't figured out. But anyway, yeah, I encourage you to check out more. It's a really fun discipline in cubing.
I see. And the other quick question I had was Rubik himself aware of the connections to group theory?
I have not spoken directly with him about this, but from other interviews I've seen, like a video presentation he did, he certainly understands this. If your specific question is, like, at the time he was doing it, did he know about this? I can't give you an answer, but I certainly wouldn't bet against it.
All right, so let's take one more question. And then Ian will be around to sign some books.
Yes, and thank you all for coming.
They're available from Posmic in the back for $10. So, yeah.
Okay.
Hi, thanks for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Quick question. So, like, there's not too many puzzles that went viral, to say that, like Rubik's Cube before that, maybe the 15 puzzle in a century ago. But do you think if there's an opportunity for a puzzle to become viral nowadays, and if there is such a puzzle that we should all be playing now, like post-Rubik's thing?
Right. That's a very interesting question, and it touches on sort of one of the deeper questions I try to get at in the book, which is like, why did this thing go viral in the first place? What makes a puzzle do that, especially nowadays when it's coming back and it's this obvious analog throwback in a very digital age? I've had a lot of parents say to me at cubing competitions, like, when my kids started doing this, I just stopped worrying about that kid. And I'm like, okay, you know. Because I sort of wondered, is it because there's now a firewall between your child and all the parties in high school? Or because, like, you know, they are like, you know, they're really into like something where it's like, oh, that, you know, cubers at Google or, you know, Stanford or whatever. It could be a bit of both, honestly. But so as far as going viral, it, you know, there's some sort of magic to it, right? Like if this were a replicable phenomenon, we would already know the next Rubik's Cube because it would be out there and we'd be playing with it. I think the reason, my best guess as to why this became so popular is that because you can't reduce it to any one thing. Like it literally has a lot of sides, so to speak. It's at once accessible. You don't, you know, it crosses all barriers you could erect in front of it, whether that's gender, nationality, language. I found an old photograph in National Geographic in a report on the Wayana, a group of people who had very little contact with Western civilization. And it's not clear why they had it, but there were two boys in loincloths in front of a hut with a Rubik's Cube. And I don't know if it fell out of a plane or like a missionary like dropped it off or the reporter herself brought it. It was never clear. But the look on their face of just like wonder and enrapturement and utter confusion was the exact same face you'd see on like an American TV show where someone had to do it back in the 80s. So there's something like really ineffable about this that connects to like deep human concerns about trying to make chaos, trying to make order out of chaos, as Mr. Rubik has put it, that is very hard to replicate in the sense that, you know, making something profound, I think, is as much a matter of chance or happenstance in the sense that even the most creative people rarely have ideas that are that connected to all kinds of other things. I would never say like, oh, well, a puzzle couldn't go viral today when we have, you know, smartphones and Candy Crush and all these sorts of things. But, you know, I think if a puzzle does go viral like that again, it will be because it does something that we couldn't have anticipated. I mean, the reason that the Rubik's Cube was so hard to market at first was because no one had ever seen anything like this. It's very different from the 15 puzzle. For those of you who don't know, the 15 puzzle is, you know, you might have seen this at like the Met gift shop, like a little square with lots of little squares, and you have to rearrange them. It's like a modern version of it. So if a puzzle does go viral, I think it will be for reasons that none of us anticipated. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
OK. Thank you all very much for having me.
Well done.
Thank you. Thanks.